So we are studying the Quranic Arabic with the help of Surah Al-Jumu'ah. And we have done the first few ayats, only actually two. And what I want to do is that in this class, we'll try to finish these three ayats. I'm going to go and do a simple translation of these ayats. So when we are breaking it down, we have the background that what is actually these ayats are referring to. So in ayat number two, the one that we did last week, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned about a prophet, a messenger, that he sent among the people of that area. And those people Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed as Ummiyin. They were not educated people. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that what was the job of this Rasul, this messenger. And there are three or four things are mentioned, that he recites the book of Allah to them, he purifies them, he teaches them the wisdom and the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So those are the functions of the messenger that we studied last week. Now the ayat today, first two ayats, are a continuation of that. What in this ayat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning, that messenger who came there, he was not only for them, but he was for all the people who will come later to live in this world. He will be a prophet and a messenger for them also. So that is the one basic message in the first two ayats that we are going to study today. The third ayat is about, it's a very important ayat. It's an example Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is quoting from the previous book that was revealed to Musa alayhi salam, Taurat. And what ayat is saying, that the people who were given, the followers of Musa alayhi salam, they were given this book to hold on, study, learn, teach, and make their life live according to the book that was revealed, which they did not do. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way they handle the book, Taurat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving an example that their scholars, their leaders, their followers of the book were not more than a donkey upon whom some books have been loaded, burdened. That's all. And if doesn't matter how important a literature is, if you put on top of a monkey, he would not understand what's the value of that material. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that is what they did. But what's the purpose of mentioning that? The purpose is that you don't do that because you are being given a book. Now you are responsible, the followers of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after him, the responsibility of carrying book has been put upon the shoulders of the followers of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Every one of them. You don't do this the way the followers of Musa alayhi salam did to Torah. Carry this book with responsibility, understand and follow it and implement in your life. So we need to look, are we doing what we are supposed to do, or we have put this book on a shelf in a nice material of cloth and put it there and forgot about it. It's eye-opening ayats of this. So I'm going to do a translation first. So this was the background, okay? So translation, and then we'll go and understand the meanings of these. So ayat starts with the A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitanir Rajeem. Wa-akharina. Akharina is from what the word akhir. Akhir is something, akhir, which comes later. That's a common word. Akharina is a plural. Those who come later, okay? So the book was revealed at the time of Prophet ﷺ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about us. we are the ones who have come later as the guardian of this book. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing actually about us, about the people who are living on the face of the earth and will continue living. So the book was given originally to the people who were called Ummiyin of the Makkah. But Akhireen are the people who come after that, and they have the responsibility of holding this book. So Akhireena, minhum, among them. Lamma, not yet. Yalhaqu bihim, have joined them. So which means, if the people of that time are being taught, we haven't joined them yet. We'll come later. So this is what it is. Allah says, وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ, and He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is almighty and all-wise. Al-Aziz and Al-Hakim. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the next ayat, ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ, this is the grace, this is the bounty, this is the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He has given you a book. يُؤْتِيهِ, He gives. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives. مَنْ يَشَاءُ, so whomsoever He wills. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose some people to be responsible for His own book. Not everybody. Okay? وَاللَّهُ, and Allah, ذُلْ فَضْلِ الْعَظِيمِ, is the owner of great bounty. Azim. Okay? Then we go to the last ayat number 5. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ, the example, the misal of those people, هُمِّلُ التَّوْرَاتَ, who were given the responsibility of carrying Tawrat, the book that was given to Musa alayhi salam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about the followers of the Musa alayhi salam, that those were the people who were entrusted with the book Tawrat. Thumma, then what they did. Thumma means then. What did they do? Lam yahmiluha, they did not carry it properly. They did not carry the responsibility of carrying the book. Yahmilu, and we'll do the breakdown. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, kamathali, their example is like what? Al-himar. Himar means donkey. The animal, donkey. Yahmilo, some books have been loaded upon him. Asfaran means books. So like a donkey, and your valuable literature you put on back of that donkey, he won't know what to do with that. Okay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, don't be like that. You have been given a book. The previous people did that. Allah says, Bi'sa is a very bad Mathalul Qawm, the example of those people. Allazina, those people, kazzabu, who denied, bi ayatillah, the verses and the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, wallahu, and Allah, la yahdi, He does not guide. Al Qawm, those people, az-zalimin, who are wrongdoers. So these are the ayats that we will learn today, inshallah. So going back, there are a few words that I want to repeat here, so because we'll be using them very often. First of all, if we have these three letters, fa and then lam, and the meaning is to do, and we have done all this, I just want to repeat here. If I put a ya in the beginning and pronounce these as yafu alu, with this harakat, this brings the meaning, this ya brings the meaning of third person, he, and also present tense. So the meaning of yaf alu is he does, or he is doing, third person and present tense. And the reason I pointed out that when we are reading several ayats, we will notice that some words are starting with the letter ya in the beginning, with a fataha. You can identify that in those words, what's being talked about is the present time. and third person. Okay, so that's an easy way to identify. So keep this in mind. Then I want to point out one more thing, that let's this time take these three letters, Ha, Lam, and Qaf. Khalaqa. Okay, this means to create. Okay, if I put three fathas on each one of them, this brings the meaning of a third person but past tense. So this will be he, third person, and past tense is created. Okay, he created. Now, two things we want to learn after that. If I put a word after that, a noun or a name, for example, Allah. Full word is Allahu. Okay? That means the last letter must have a dhamma on it, a pesh. Allahu. Okay? So I'm going to recite this khalaqallahu, okay, reading together. But what is this word is doing if last letter is a dhamma on it? The way it is should be understood is that if I in English write down Allah and this has a dhamma, then this will cross out he. And the meaning will be Allah created. Allah created. So whenever you have a pronoun in a word, like he did or he created, and if you have a noun after that, name, that has dhamma on it, only dhamma. If it is khalaqallah and it was fata or kasra, that will not do it. If it was allaha or allahi, that won't do it. Only last letter dhamma means it will replace this he, and the meaning will be Allah created. So just remember these few things because we'll be using them today in the translation. Now, let's look at the first letter, Waw with a fataha. Waw. Waw means end. Okay, so some ayahs start with the letter Waw, end. And this happened, and that happened, okay, and you did this. So that is the style of starting an ayat, starts with Waw. Okay, even though Waw is and means you are joining two sentences, but here you can assume that this is joining the previous sentence that we learned earlier. Okay, then the word Alif, Hamza with the Alif, should be read as in the Indo-Pak font as two alifs, or this way, ah. Okay, that's the representation of a hamza and alif in the Quranic script. This is the sound of this way, ah, means two alifs stretch, ah. And if I put these three letters, akhirun. Almost everybody knows Akhir means the one who comes later. Akhir is the person who comes later or last. Okay? So the one who comes later. Akhirina in the Quran is the plural of this.
Akhirina.
Akhirina, yeah.
Akhirina
means
other.
This is Akhir, sorry.
Yeah, Akhir is later.
Yeah. Akhir means later. Okay.
Akhir is other.
Other, yeah. So this is later other. Okay, akhar. Its plural is akharina. Those who will come later, you can think of that. Quran was given to the people who were living at that time. Okay, but it was given for all the mankind, those who were going to come later. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we can assume we are akharin, we are the others later. Okay, akharina. So, akhar is one person who comes later. Akharina is the plural, means all the people who come later. Then there are these words, min and plus whom. Okay. Min is among here, and whom is them. These are the common words. We have to just learn them for the beginners. Whom means plural, them or they. Min whom means among them. Okay? Then let's learn the next word. I'm going to go over these two words, lam and lamma. Okay. These are the two words. Actually, lamma is coming now here, and lam comes somewhere down there. Lam yahmiluha. So let's understand both of these words. These words, okay, another word I'm going to write down here, la. Okay. La means simply not. Okay. Lam and lamma both have the meaning not, but they are used in a different sense. So now I'll go over that one. Okay. So the meaning of lam first is also not, and meaning of this word is not yet. The way we use in English, not yet. Okay? Lam means not, but lam is not yet. Okay? And when I write down a word, we'll understand exactly. Okay? Okay. So let's write down, for learning purposes, these three letters, fa'ala. Fa'ala means to do. Okay? We'll use this template for learning. Okay? Remember when I say that if I put a ya in the beginning and make it yaf'alu, this brings the meaning of third person and present tense. He does. Okay? So the meaning of this word is he does. Now I'm going to put a waw. Waw brings the plural. Okay? So the word will be pronounced yaf'alu. Okay? Yaf'alu means they do or they are doing. Okay? So this letter waw, ya, brings third person and present tense. Okay. Wow makes it plural. Okay. Yaf'alu. So you can say the meaning so far is they do or they are doing. Okay. Now what we do, we put a noon at the end. So the full word is yaf'aluna. Okay? The meaning is still same. They are doing or they do. But this noon has a very special purpose. And it will become clear to you. So, and this noon has a name. It's called noon Arabi. It's used for some grammatical reason. Okay? So the word is yaf'aluna. They do. So meaning is they do. Okay. Now let's take the word lam. Okay. So I'm going to erase this thing. Okay. I'm going to put the word lam and tell you what lam does. And I'm also going to write down the word. Actually, the words are written here. I can explain here. We don't need this la here because that is simple not. Okay. So when we put a lam before this word, or we put lamma before this word, something happens. Okay. What happens? The first thing happens is that it gives the negative meaning. This is positive meaning, and this will become it a negative meaning. I went, I did not go, something like that. Yes and no. Okay. Second thing it does, so this is the first thing it does. It brings the meaning of no or not yet. The second thing lam or lamma do is that they pull in past. And third thing they will do, last letter, sukoon. So now, these three things. Now I'm going to put this lam here. Or lamma. Okay. So the meaning will become negative. Instead of they do, it becomes they don't do. But I said it pulls into the past tense. So the meaning will be they did not do. They did not do. And also, it puts a sukoon on the last letter. So this becomes a sukoon. And this vow has a sukoon. Okay, when there are two letters with the sukoon, you cannot pronounce. So we kill this noon because we had added that one for this purpose. Okay, so the word is lam yaf'alu. Lam yaf'alu means they did not do, past tense. Okay. And if I put lamma, it will be lamma yaf'alu. They have not done it yet. See, the meaning of lamma is not yet. So the meaning will be in the past tense, they have not done yet. So see, we made a big sentence in English with very simple changes in Arabic. So lamma yal yaf'alu means they have not done yet. Okay. Keep this format in mind. These are three letters: lam, ha, kaf. This means to join. Or meet. Lahaqa means to join. Okay?
Catch
or join, yeah. Catch. There are many meanings there. Okay, so if I apply this, all you have to do is replace fa and lam. So this will become lamma yalhaqu. Same words in the Quran. Okay? Lamma yalhaqu. They have not joined yet. They have not met yet. Okay? They have not joined yet. The people who will come later, after the Quran was revealed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling at that time to the people that there are other people who have not joined yet. They will come later and they will follow the Quran. Okay? So it's a news being given to the people there at that time, that there will be some akharina, there will be some other people who will be later. Among them, lamma yalhaqu, they have not joined yet, means they were going to come later. Okay. So this Quran is not only for you. This will be also for the people who will be coming later. Lamma yalhaqu bihim. Bihim is with, and hum means them. Bihim means with them. So this message is being given to the people who are receiving the Quran, that there will be people who will come later, who have not joined them yet, they will come later, and this Quran is for them also. Very powerful message is being given to those people. And they should have this hope at that time, those who understood this really, that, oh, this Quran is not going to go away. This is not a short-term book that came and will go away. It's being sent for long-term people, long time later. Okay? So this is the meaning of this ayat. Okay. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Wa huwa. Huwa means he. Huwallahu, kul huwallahu ahad. Huwa means he, and it is pointing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he. Okay. And he. And then these are two asma'ul husna of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are being mentioned. Al-Aziz and Al-Hakim. Al-Aziz means the most powerful, the almighty. Okay. And Al-Hakim, the most wise, with the wisdom. Okay. So these are the two asma'ul husna of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which are being mentioned here in this ayat. Okay. These are asma'ul husna, people know them, they know the meaning. But that's what I was want to briefly go, because in the Asma'ul Husna, which are the 99 known names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, mostly they start with the word Al. Al means the. Aziz means the powerful, mighty. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al Aziz and Al Hakim, the most wise. Then let's move on to the next ayat. Dhalika. Dhalika means that, or sometimes this. If you point to something which is at a distance, Dhalika, that thing over there. So that is the meaning of Dhalika. Okay. Zalikam is that. Okay. Now, these three letters, Fa, Duad, and Nam. Fadl. Fadala means to have bounty or grace. This is a common name also. Fazal, that we say. Bounty and Rahmah and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, Fadlun. Fadlun means bounty. Rahma, mercy, or whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you is His bounty. He's bountiful. So that is the bounty. Okay. Now also, so we learned a while ago that if you have one noun and this means bounty, and here you have another noun, let's take this time, Allahu, Allah. And as I mentioned that these are two independent words, bounty and Allah. And we learned the rule that if you want to join them, relate them, we can put an off in between. Okay, and there is a name for that, but this is, we are relating two words. So the two words together become bounty of Allah, fadl of Allah, okay? So in English, we put an off. In Arabic, we do a few more things to bring that meaning. What we do instead of putting an off, we remove one dhammas from here, it becomes fadlu. On this word, we take a dhamma and replace with a kasra. These two changes are bringing the meaning of here. Okay? When we read them together, we do not pronounce this alif in between. So when we don't pronounce, we take this thing and put a little swad on it. Okay? It's called Hamzatul Wasl. Wasl means we join two words, drop alif. So the word became Fadlullahi. Full word is Fadlullahi, that's the meaning of bounty of Allah, grace of Allah, rahmah of Allah, mercy of Allah. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is the fadl of Allah. Dhalika fadlullahi. This is the rahmah, this is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has given you a book. So you can guide your life with that. Okay? Fadlullah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after that says that this is His choice. Allah will give His book and His guidance to whomsoever He wants. Because He has the power, He has the authority, He has the choice. So He does whatever He wants to do. He gave the guidance, book and guidance to you. You're lucky, you're fortunate. He didn't give to somebody else, some other nation. So this is His choice. Okay? So now let's look at the next word. Yu'tihi. Okay? First thing try to identify is that the first letter is a ya. Okay? That means this word has present tense in third person. Yaf'alu. Okay? But let's break it down the word. It starts with these three letters, Alif, Ta, and Ya. Okay. These are the three root letters, and the meaning of this is to come. Okay. These are three letters. We are going to make a word by adding one more letter, another Alif in the beginning. It becomes a different word because now it is a four letters. And that's how in Arabic we make bigger words by adding letters here and there. Okay? So this four letters has the meaning of to give. Okay. And when you have two alifs, they have to be pronounced as ah. This is ata, this is ata. So this two alifs have to be pronounced as I mentioned, in Quran they can be written this way or this way, but has to be long sound, ah, okay? So this word is ata, okay? When we put a, in the four letter words, when you put a ya in the beginning, we have to put a dhamma, okay? And then we have this yu'ti, and the, I'll explain to you, but that meaning He gives. Ya bring the meaning of third person and present tense. That what we have been learning. Ya brings the meaning of third person and present tense. If these are three letters, we put a fatha on the ya. But if it is four letters, we put a dhamma. That's the only difference. So yu'ti means He gives. Yu'ti means He gives. You have a question?
Is it yu'ti to give or
yu'ti? I'll go a little bit more. This one. So the sound is that you had a hamza here, right?
Yeah.
So you combine ya with the hamza, right? So it becomes sound of you, ya with hamza, right? Now in writing, whenever hamza is sitting by itself, we have to put a, it's called a chair to hold the hamza, okay? So what we do, we put a chair here, wow. We don't pronounce this vowel. Don't pronounce you like U-T, like English Y-O-U. Don't pronounce, because this vowel really doesn't exist anywhere. It is just giving some support to Hamza. It is called a chair for Hamza. Because Hamza in the writing script cannot support himself or itself. So what we do, we either put an alif or vowel or ya to support, and it's called chair for Hamza. So even though wow is written, don't pronounce wow. Pronounce ya with Hamza, and its sound should not be long sound. If you made it long sound of you, means you are pronouncing wow. If you don't, then they give it you. Did I answer your question or no, not yet? This one?
Yeah.
Okay. Bring meaning comes when there's a ba after that. Ata bi. Meanings is bring. If ba is not after that, then it is give. Okay. So, yuvuti, he gives, and the word is who after that. Who means it or he. This is, it is pointing to the Quran or the book. Okay? So you now combine and write down these words together. So they will be written as you. Combined with Hamza, vowel is not to be read. T is being written this way. Okay? And this who is being written as this way. One thing will happen, okay? If I just leave who there, its sound will be you, ti, who. You, ti, who. But this is a kasra here, and this is a ya. They both are comparable sounds coming out from the same makhraj place of the mouth. So to make it a rhythmic sound, make it beautiful sound, we pronounce this as a he also. Pronounce only. So it becomes yuti he. If you try to pronounce yuti hu, you have to move your tongue up and down a couple times. Okay, but if you change to a yi, so then all of them are yi, 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 and they are coming out from the same place in the mouth. So this is the pronunciation change, not grammatical change. Grammatically, you cannot change a letter without any reason. Pronounce, you cannot change at all. Only.
Would it be wrong to say? Would it be wrong to say?
If it is by itself, you have to say who.
Yeah.
But if it is connected to the letters before or the words before which are carrying the same sound, then keep the same sound pronunciation.
But the same meaning, right?
Meaning doesn't change. It's just a tajweed. Yeah. The meaning, there is no other meaning. It only. Okay? So, yu'tihi, he gives. Allah gives. It means this book, okay, or the Quran, or the message. Man yashau, okay. So let's look at that word. There are variation of these words we use all the time, okay. So, Sheen, Alif, and Hamza, these three letters. This means to desire or to will. Okay? We use this word all the time, inshallah. Sha'a. Okay? So when we put a ya in the beginning, it becomes third person, he, and present tense. Yaf'alu. Okay, just keep in mind. So this becomes yashau. He, third person, wills, present tense. And he is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. He wills. Or he is willing. We use the word insha'a. In means if. If Allah willing. But here, he is talking, he wills, and man means whosoever, whomsoever. Man means whomsoever. So Allah gives his fadl, his bounty, whomsoever he wills, whomsoever he decides, whomsoever he desires, he gives his bounty to that person or that nation or those people. Okay, so this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's choice. Now two things. When in the recitation, if you have an alif or a ya or a waw, any of these three letters are there, and after these three letters, if there is a hamza, I'll just skip to hamza. If in the writing you see alif, waw, or ya, and after that you see a hamza, then it has a backward effect. In the tajweed, you have to pronounce these three letters with mad. Okay, so this will be pronounced as mad. This will be pronounced as mad. Yasha'u. You have to stretch it. In we call alif, they call hamza, for simple reason. Okay, this vertical line is nothing. The difference between these two.
Yes.
This is, you want to tell what's the difference?
Alif is harf alif. It comes to give them the word a sound, like waw and ya. Hamza is a letter. It's harf like sheen, like ba. So when we use hamza by itself at the beginning of the word, we have to add alif because it cannot be pronounced by itself. We don't start with sukoon, and hamza is the only letter in the Arabic which is sukoon. So and when we cannot start with sukoon, we have to add alif to it.
So in Indo-Pak script and Uthmani, the language which is spoken in Arabic and written there, there are three weak letters, alif, ya, and waw. Okay, these are called huruf illat or weak letters. Okay, and they can be modified, but there hamza is a letter, complete letter. Okay, like jim, like dal, like ra, hamza is a letter. Okay. So this is a letter, and this is a sound, this like this one, okay, so the vertical line, weak letter. You can say one is solid letter, one is weak letter, because its sound can be changed, we can move around, we just change the sound of this alif. If hamza was not there, you just pronounce short, ah, but now we have changed the sound, became ah. Okay, so okay, the other thing I want to point out, that when meem and noon and ya come together in the tajweed, you pronounce noon gunna. Man yasha'u, not man anymore, man. Okay, so that's another rule of tajweed, and for that purpose they usually put a shadda here. Man yasha'u. So Allah gives his fadl, his bounty, to whomsoever he wills. Okay, he wants. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning himself again. Wallahu, and Allah. Here, he used a pronoun for himself, wahuwa. But this time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using a noun. Okay, same format. Okay, and this time he is using a different asmaul husna. Okay, but the first word here, let me go over there. The first word we just learned, fa, duad, lam. And the noun we learned, fadlun, was bounty or grace or honor. Okay. Fadlun. Okay. This word dhu this has a meaning. It means the owner. Dhu means the owner. Owner and fadlun. And before that you put al here. Al means the. Okay. And what al does? It removes one dhamma. Okay. So this word is al-fadlu. This word can be written as al-fadlu. Al-fadlu means the bounty. Okay. And this word is the zoo, owner. And this is the bounty. These are two independent words. One is owner, one is the bounty. If I want to combine them, I'm going to put an off in between. Owner of the bounty means he is the owner of everything. Owner, wala. Okay, owner. So when we put often in English, what we have to do? We have to, second word goes to kasra, and this already had one, so nothing will happen there. Okay, when you read together. You read Zal combined with the Lam, Zul. Okay. When we read them together, we don't pronounce this. Zul Fadli, owner of the bounty. He is the owner of anything that he grants to others. Okay. Zul Fadli. And this word al-azimu. Okay, so let's look at that word. Ain, zwa, and meem. This means to be great and azimun means great. Okay, when we put a ya, it becomes the intensity, the greatness. Rahim, Kareem, Azim, Azimun. Then you put Al before that. So it become Al Azimu. When we put Al, last letter becomes one Dhamma. Al Azimu means the great, the greatest. Okay. So now, this is Al-Fadl. Zul-Fadl means owner of the bounty. And this is coming as a sifat of that bounty, the great bounty. Azim is not coming for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here. It's coming for the bounty. The great bounty. The big bounties. Okay? So this word is coming as an adjective or sifat of Fadl. And whenever it comes an adjective, it has to follow the adjective. So azimu will become azimi because it is fadli. These rules keep coming back and forth. So when we stop, we don't pronounce azimi, we pronounce azim. Okay? So Allah is the owner of the great bounties. Great Fadl. Okay, so that's this ayah. Okay, so now I want to go.
So Zalika Fadlullah. Zalika means that.
that. That is pointing to giving the book to
Ummijin. Is there a verb in there?
In Zalika?
Yeah, is that, that is, or that's?
That, such, such, there is no verb, this is not a verb. This is called Isma Ishara. It's something you point to something.
This is.
Is, use this thing.
But he meant like this is, that is.
Yeah, that is.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is, yeah.
Yeah.
That is, right? So is.
No, no, is being put in English.
Okay.
Yeah, in English you put is there, but it's not in there.
So, because otherwise it's that Fadlullah.
Yeah, that's
but something is missing in English translation.
So, you have, in English you have to fill in there.
Yeah.
Okay. But is not in Arabic. Okay. So the next ayah, mathal, these are common words, meem, seen, and lam. We start with those three letters. Meem, sa, not seen, lam, mathal. Okay. Now, let's just do the first one. So, masalun is the word. Masalun means example, similitude, misal. Okay, in Urdu they call misal. Okay, masalun. Okay, similitude, count. Okay, and always noun has to the mas at the end, pronounced masalun. Okay, then you have, so this means example. Then you have the word alladhina. Okay, so the word ladhi means he. Ladhi means he, third person, masculine. Okay. Ladhina is the plural. Those. Okay. So those. And we have al before that, talking about some special people. Those people. Okay. So these are two independent words. Do the same thing. Put an off in between. The example of those people. Okay. The few basic rules, if we comprehend, it's very easy to break down and understand the ayats of the Quran. Okay. Now we have been saying that when we put an off, what we do in Arabic, we do two things in Arabic. We first one, we change to dhammas to one dhamma. So this word become mathalu. Okay? This word, we always been saying that there is a dhamma and make it a kasra there. But this is a pronoun. Pronouns don't change. Pronouns are very stubborn. The only thing when they change, when you pronounce them. So you can pronounce who to he. Yutihu to yutihi. Grammatically, you cannot touch them. So, alladhina will remain alladhina. And you read together, don't pronounce this alif. Mathalul ladhina, the example of those. Mathalul ladhina, the example of such those people. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving an example of some nation or some people who lived before. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning Mathalul Lazina. Okay, now let's break down a word which is coming here twice in slightly different meanings. Okay. So these are the three letters, Ha, Mim, and Lam. Okay. The simplest meaning of this is to carry. Okay. And we, in Urdu, they use these words all the time. I'm sure in Arabic too. A female who is carrying, we call Hamila, from the same letters. Okay. So hamala means to carry. Yeah, that is hamela means pregnant. Yeah, it means carrying a burden, you know, load. Okay, extra. Okay, so that is the meaning of ha, mim, and lam. Now, if I take the same three letters and put a shadda on the middle letter, and we have seen example a few times before. That when we add another letter in the middle as a shadda, which middle letter is twice, the meaning changes. Like alama se allama, sabaha sabbaha. Okay, so the meaning changes. Okay, so hammala is means. Okay, so now in general, when you make a bigger word, then more than one person is involved. Okay. So you can say, okay, going back to alama, three letters, ayn, lam, and mim. Alama means to know or to learn something. But when I put a shadda, it becomes allama. Allama means to teach. So now two people are involved. One is giving, one is taking. Okay, in allama, allama is just one person learning. Allama is two people, one giving, one taking. Okay, let's try to do this similar breakdown. These three letters, someone is carrying something. Okay, when we put a shadda, that means two people are involved. Okay, our logic is that, and one is giving, one is taking, right? So meaning of this word will be, you are given to carry something. Here you are carrying yourself. But here, one person is giving somebody else to carry something. If I say, carry this thing for me, put this load on your back and walk. So I'm telling you to do the activity because two people are involved, okay? If Allah is giving a book to you, wouldn't you use this word for hammala? He is telling you, take this book, go, carry this with you. In English, there is a good word, entrusted. Okay, the word entrusted is means that something has been given to you to be responsible of. That's how you entrust. You give some responsibility to someone, position to someone, and you're entrusting that person with the responsibility. So, hammala means that meaning. Entrust, given responsibility. Okay, and I said that when you put a vowel, it becomes plural. So this become hummilu. Hummilu means they were given responsibility to carry something. They were entrusted with the book of Allah. Alladhina, Allah says the example of those people who were given the responsibility of carrying at-Tawrat. The book of Torah that was given to Musa alayhi salam, but his followers were made responsible for carrying the book. So in fact, even though it was revealed upon Musa alayhi salam, he was not supposed to just keep with him and leave this world, but his followers, Bani Israel, were entrusted to carry that book. And implement and follow, okay? Just like Quran was given to one prophet and his followers were entrusted to carry the book after him, okay? So this example, instead of, once we have finished the translation, instead of condemning the other people, we should look at ourselves. What have we done with the book that was entrusted to us? Yes.
So hamala in the beginning, the ha has a hamilu dhamma, is it strictly because it's plural?
No, plural. Okay. in this bab number 2, the grammar is made with a dhamma. Okay, it's number 2. Number 1, it's a passive also. They were, when you make it passive, then it becomes dhamma also. They were given, it is a passive, that they did not take it themselves. They were given to carry the book. They were given responsibility to carry the book. Hummelu. Okay? So Allah says, those people, example of those people who were given to carry the book. Okay? Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning what was that they were given to carry. And the name is a specific At-Tawrat. At-Tawrat is Torah in English. Okay. So those people who were given the responsibility, those who were entrusted for Torah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what happened? Thumma. Okay. Thumma means then. Means after they carried the book, then. Summa comes when something happens and something after that happens, then. Okay, first they were given the book, then what happened after that? So Summa is coming for that. Okay, now. So we just learned in the beginning of the class, lam yaf'alu. You look at your notes, lam yaf'alu. Okay. We started with fa'ala, to do, then we made yaf'aluna, they do, then put the lam, which takes out nu. And the meaning becomes, they did not do. They did not do. Important thing is that the whole meaning has to be understood with the help of lamma. They did not do. We use the word lamma, which brought the meaning of yet. But if lamma is not there, lam is there, you don't need yet in there. Okay? So lam yaf'alu. Okay? If you change these three letters here, fa'ala, instead of that, hamala, it becomes lam yam. Lam, yahmilu, high separate. Lam yahmilu, they did not carry it. They were given the responsibility, but they did not do the. Okay, now, don't think that they refused to take it. They took it, but they did not fulfill the right of carrying it. They still have it, they still say, this is our book, we're carrying it. But what is written inside and what they are doing are two different things. So that is the meaning, they did not carry it. Ha means it. Ha is pointing to Taurat. This word ha here means it. Okay. Remember that middle letter can carry fatha, dhamma, and kasra. So it is at the wazan of samia, daraba, yadribu. Yadribu has a kasra in the middle letter. So this is at the wazan of daraba, yadribu. Okay? So ha means it. Okay? Ha means it. And this is pointing to Taurat. They did not carry it. They did not fulfill the responsibility of carrying the book, Torah, that was given to them. Okay? So they see the beauty in the difference. Here is saying that they were given to carry it as a responsibility, and then what happened? They did not carry it. They did not fulfill their duties, responsibilities. They took it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what happens after that? Okay? So let's look at that. Okay. We just learned this word, masalun. Masalun means example. Okay? Then this word al-himaru. Himaru means donkey. This is an animal. Himar. Al-himaru, the donkey. Al means the. Okay. Masalun is actually masalun. Okay. Masalun means example. Al-himaru, the donkey. Now put an of in between. Example of the donkey. Okay. So what happens when we put of in between? We take these two and change to one dhamma. We take this one and change to kasra. Okay? So this become masalu and this become al-himari. Then you read together, you do not pronounce this alif in between. So this thing becomes a little swath. Okay? So it became Masalul Himari, combined with this lam. Masalul Himari, the example of the donkey. Okay? Now I'm going to add one more word here. Kaf with a kasfataha ka. Kam is like. Or as. Okay. This is a letter, is a harf jar, like ba and min and all those we have been learning. And what harf jar does? Harf jar takes this next last letter and change into a kasra. Allahu becomes Allahi when harf jar is before. Minallahi. Okay, min is a harf jar. Allahu becomes Allahi. Ka is a harf jar. So masalo became masali. Okay.
So always kasra.
Always kasra. Jar means kasra. Okay. So this becomes a jar and this is the harf jar. Okay. So now read this. This is in the Quran now. Kamathalil himari. Is the example of a donkey. The example of those people, now start again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, example of those people, masalul lazina, hummilu taurata, those who were entrusted with the Taurat, thumma, after that, lam yahmiluha, they did not carry the responsibility. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, their example is the example of a donkey. كَمَثَلِ الْحِمَارِ كَمَثَلِ الْحِمَارِ. This word hamala again coming. Okay, so if you put a ya in the beginning, present tense third person, yahmilo, he carries, donkey carries. Once you comprehend the basic basic rules of how the words are combining, making, affecting each other, it becomes very easy to understand the Quran. Okay? So, Yahmilu, he carries. The donkey carries. What he carries? Sin, Fa, Ra. These are the root letters. It has many meanings. The common meaning that we mean is to journey, travel, suffer. Okay? The one of the meaning of this word is Safarun. Means a book, a scroll, something written. Safarun also means book. Sifrun. So this is Sifrun?
Yes.
Okay. I thought it's a Khabarun, Akhbarun.
Khabar is different. Okay. Safar is travel.
Yeah, Safarun is travel and Sifrun is the book. Okay, so that's the difference in the basic structure. Okay, so Sifrun, its plural is Asfarun. Okay, so if you make a plural of this word, it is Asfarun. Asfarun means books.
Is it like the kitab is book? So what's the difference here?
A scroll written.
It's the written books. It's the narrated books.
Sifr, books are news. The kitab is not
that has a news.
Yeah.
Sifr is the book that has a news.
Has brand new.
That has a news.
Has news in it.
News in it.
Sifrun is a book that has some news, information. Oh, well, other books have information too, but this is another word in all this. So, Yahmilu Asfa, remember that now. One more thing, I'm going to just briefly mention here, because that's important rule also. There is a word here. Let's look at this word. Al-insan. Okay? Al-insan. If I put the harakat, it becomes al-insa, and the word is with the dhamma. I'm going to write down the same word again. Al-insa. And this time I'm going to put this a fatah there. Dhamma and a fatah. Al-insan, the word is same, the meaning is same, the man. Okay? But what's the difference in these two words? Once you call it al-insano, once you call it an-insana. It's a very fundamental difference in that, which doesn't exist in other language. For example, in English. In English, man is man, right? Okay, but by adding this further information, changing this last letter, Dhamma to Fatha, we are putting more information in this word. And the information is this. This man can do something. This man cannot do anything. Which means someone else is working on this man. This man, if he is going somewhere, he is going on his own, so he is able to do something, he will be called al-insano. But if someone is helping this man, then this man himself is not doing anything. Someone is working on this man. So this is just like a fa'il and maf'ul. This is like subject and object. In English, it's called subject and object. So just by changing these letters, we are putting additional information that just by looking at this last letter, you can say, oh, this man is not doing anything. This man, someone is doing something on that. Okay? The word is asfarun. But I put to fatha as faran, same rule. I change dhamma to a fatha there. Okay? Which means the books themselves are not doing anything. Someone is carrying the book. Donkey is carrying the book. Okay? So the additional information is put in the word itself as if the word is object or subject. Meaning does not change. So the meaning is that example of a donkey who is carrying a load of books. Asfara. When you stop, you say asfara, otherwise it's asfarun. Originally it was asfaran, originally it was asfarun, the books. But books are not doing anything, someone is carrying them, so they are object. So when a word comes as an object, you change to the must to two fathas. Okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, bi'itha. Bi'itha means bad. Evil. This word, just have to learn the meaning. Bi'itha means bad. Okay? Now, again, this word is coming again. Masalun, example. Okay? And qawmun, qawm is pupil. Qawm means pupil. Full word is qawmun, nation, pupil. Qawmun, okay? People. Okay. So first thing you want to do is put an al before that. Al. The people. And what al does? Al changes these two to one. So the word is al qawmu. Al qawmu means the people. Okay? This is one word, masalun. This is another word, al qawmu. Okay? Now what you want to do, you want to put an off in between. Example of the people. Okay? And we keep coming across this thing. Off will take out one dhamma from here. And we'll make this one to kasra. And don't pronounce this alif. Swad. Mathalul qawmi. That's the word there. Mathalul qawmi. Is bad is the example of these people. Allah says this is a really bad thing. It's not nothing to be happy about if you are being regarded as donkeys. Because you did not do justice with the book of Allah. Okay? And we should not laugh because we are doing the same thing. Okay? With the Quran, you know. Okay. Alladhina, Alladhina means those people. This word came across. Okay? So who are these people? Let's look at that. Again, these three letters, Kaf, Dal, and Ba. These three letters means to lie. Someone is lying. Kadaba. Okay? Three letters, okay? Now I'm going to do the same thing, put a shadda on the middle letter. It became kazzaba this time. Okay? What's the meaning here? To deny. Now, remember the rule of why we put a shadda on the middle letter, what it does, first of all, it brings two people, more than. For denying, you need two people. Someone is saying to you, and you're denying. So you need two people, okay? For lying, you can lie by one person, okay? So two people are needed here. One is saying something, one is saying, no, you're wrong, rejecting that. So that's a denial, okay? So that's the difference in the meaning here. Kadhaba is just to lie, one person. Kadhaba, one person is saying something, the other person is saying no. So that's called denying, okay? Or making the person as a liar. If the person says that this is something, and you say, no, this is nothing, you're making that person look like a liar. So denying or making it a liar, kadhaba. So when we put three fathas on this, kadhaba, three fathas, it becomes third person in past tense. He denied. When we put three fathas, fa'ala, he did. Kadhaba, he denied. And when you put a vowel, it becomes plural. They denied. Alladhina kazzabu, those people who denied. What did they deny? The ayatillah. The signs, the verses of Allah, the revelation of Allah. Some people stood up and said, no, this is not what Allah meant. This is what it is. They're rejecting the ayats of Allah. Maybe in Torah, you know. Hiding, misinterpreting, saying this is what Allah revealed, and actually, alhamdulillah, Muslims have not done that kind of thing with the Quran. But Bani Israel have done those things to the book of Allah, Torah. Well, Quran tells that for a small amount of money, they told that this is written in the Torah, it was not written in the Torah. اشترو بآياتي ثمنا قليلا. They took small gains for the verses of Allah. Okay, so they did those kind of thing with the book of Allah, Torah. Okay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says this is the bad example, and these are the people who have denied the signs or the verses of Allah, ayatullah. So again, just to explain that, the word is ayatun. Ayatun means a sign or a verse, one verse of Quran or a sign. Okay, it's called one ayat. Its plural is ayatun. Okay. Verse, and this is verses. Because when we talk about a book has verses in it. Okay. Ayatun means verses or the revelation. Okay. So this means verses. And then use the word. Full word is Allahu. Okay. The two words do the same thing, put an off in between. Okay. So I think you should now understand very much this, what off does this all the time, okay? This rule is called in Arabic, mudaf, mudaf ilayh. The word mudaf means idafa. Idafa means to add something, okay? The word idafa means adding something. It's Urdu's word, okay? So what we are doing, we are adding one word into the other word and making a relationship between these two words. And in English, we just put an off. Okay, but in Arabic, both of the words are affected. So what we do? First word, we change this to one dhamma. Second word, we change to kasra. Okay? Then don't pronounce this one and becomes swat. So the sound becomes ayatullahi. Ayatullahi verses of Allah. Okay? Now I'm going to put a letter B, okay, which means off. It's a harf-e jar. So what harf-e jar does? It changes this to that. Bi ayatillahi. Those who denied the of the verses of Allah. Formation is exactly same. Ayati and Allahi, the words are exactly as come out of the grammar. Okay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a rule, a principle, okay, a sunnah, which is those who will deny his ayat, he will not guide them. Okay? Which is the next part. Wallahu and Allah. Okay. La Yahdi. Okay. So Ha Da and Ya means to guide. Ha Da and Ya means to guide. Hidayat is from the same root letters. Okay, to guide. Yahdi we put a ya in the beginning, it becomes third person. He and present tense. Present tense is guides. Okay. Yahdi, he guides. Okay. La Yahdi, he does not guide. Lam is not. And I'll tell you one more thing, but let's just first understand. La Yahdi, he does not guide. Okay? Who does not guide what? Or whom? Al Qawmul Zalimeen. Okay? Qawm means the people. And zalimin, wrongdoer, zalim. Okay, zalimin is the plural. Okay, and I'll explain this word. But one thing I want to point out that in here, la yahdi, the word he is there, right? Third person. Which one? No. That becomes past tense.
Oh, okay.
Remember that I explained that if you put a lam or lamma, it goes into the past tense. Here it is going to remain present tense. Okay. If you put a lam, it will become he did not guide. But his rule is that he is not going to guide in the future also. So past, present, future, general, Allah does not guide. Okay. Now he is a third person, but the word is Allahu. Okay, I can put Allah after or before, but there's a difference. Okay, first if I put, let's do this one. Okay, this means he does not guide. If I put the word Allahu after this, Okay, this word will just cancel out this he, and the translation will be Allah does not guide. Okay, but if I put this word in the beginning, okay, this time the meaning will become slightly different. The meaning will be, it is Allah who does not guide. See the difference in the English? Allah does not guide. So you're not saying that somebody else may also not guide. Okay? But when you put the doer in the beginning, when you say to the child, it is you who did this thing, you are saying that, no, nobody else did that. You are the one who is doing it. So you're putting the full responsibility by saying the it is you. Okay? It's the same thing. Wallahu, it is Allah who will not guide. Absolutely. Emphasis being given by putting Allahu before, then Allahu after. Okay? Guidance, you know, it's happening from Allah, but emphasis is not there. So here it is emphasis. And it is Allah who does not guide. Okay? Who does not he guide? Al-Qawmuz-Zalimeen. Okay? See, it's simple. We just learned the word Al-Qawm means the people. And so let's just do that. We just learned the word Al-Qawmu. Al-Qawmu. Then these three letters, law, lam, and meem, this means to do wrong. Zalimun is the person who does wrong. Zalim or zalimun is the full word, wrongdoer. Its plural is zalimuna. Wrongdoers. Zalimuna. Muslimun, one Muslim, muslimuna, plural. When we stop, we say muslimun. Okay? So similarly, Zalimun is one wrongdoer, Zalimuna are all those who are doing wrong, plural of that, okay? So we are, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that the people who are Zalimun, the people who are Zalimun, now, this is also mudaf mudaf ilayh. Yeah. So what is happening when you combine the two words? We have these two words now. Al-qawmu and az-zalimuna. Zalimuna, al-zalimuna. Just want to point out one rule. Az-zalimuna. Okay. Sifr. What's that?
Sifr.
Sifr. Okay.
Al-Qawma.
Al-Qawma is the word is Al-Qawma in the Quran?
Al-Qawma. Al-Qawma before.
Yeah. So this meme has the fatha on it. Okay. Okay. So remember that the word is Al-Qawmu. The word is Al-Qawmu, the people. Okay? We just learned two words, Al-Insano and Al-Insana. What was the difference? If insan was doing something, he will be Al-Insano. If someone is doing something, he will become Al-Insana. Okay? Here, someone is not guiding, these people. So these people themselves are not doing anything, someone else is working. So when someone else is working on this, it will become insana al-qawma. So the difference is between al-qawmo and al-qawma is people themselves doing something is al-qawmo. If someone is working on these people, al-qawma. Okay? Subject and object, fa'il and maf'ul. Okay? So here Allah is working on these people. He is not guiding them. Okay? So these people are being worked on. So they will become al-qawma. Okay? And this is the sifat of those people, the quality of these people, because they are zalimun. Okay? And when we change this al-qawma to al-qawma, this has to change, and the rule is here that instead of this waw, if it's a plural, we put a ya there. So it becomes zalimina. Meaning does not change, it just tells you that zalimina are also being worked on. Okay? Because they belong to the qawm. Qawm is being worked on, this is being sent away from the guidance. Allah is not guiding those people. Okay? So that is the meaning of this very powerful ayat, Surah Jum'ah. And I think two more, after next class, are the ayat about Salatul Jum'ah. That's the meaning, this is the reason this Surah Jum'ah was revealed. That commandments were given to go for the Salatul Jummah, for the Friday prayer. So we'll, inshallah, when we get there, we'll do the breakdown of those things. So inshallah, we'll stop here.